Many years ago, I was younger. I was actually starting out in my working life, and I had been hired by a program to do migrant education in California, and they wanted me to go around and give talks in the community to, you know, get referrals for the program. And I had a friend that I knew who had organized the hospital laundry workers. She'd unionized them, and she had done a lot of public speaking. So I called her and I said, "Irmachine, I've got to give these talks. What advice can you give me?" And she said, "Oh, that's easy, honey. You just keep to what you know and don't use the F word." So I promise you I will keep to what I know. And one of the fun things we're having to do in the monks' quarters is organize all the donated books that are over there. And all of us have been kind of going through them and finding these classics or books we've heard about. And this is one of my once-a-year books. It's Karen Armstrong's biography of the Buddha. It's in the... She was probably most famous for a book called The Biography of God. And then another one. She was a Catholic nun, and she left the order and became a... actually, she taught in a Jewish seminary. So she's quite the historian of religions. And I remember in an interview I saw with her early on, she said, "Oh, when I was in the nuns, I never could figure out how to meditate. I never could sit still. And so I've just given up on it. I never even tried." And years later, after she finished this book, and she had spoken to a lot of Buddhist scholars and experts, and she was taught how to meditate. And she's really happy that she finally has this skill. The skill of sitting still. It's a radical thing to do nothing. Radical, remember, means, is from the same word as radish, or in Spanish it's raíz, the root, the very core of something. And at the beginning of this biography of the Buddha, she gives a kind of overview of what was going on in his time and place. And it's very similar to what's going on in our time and our place. Let me... XXV looks like 25 in the introduction. The biography of a person who has been canonized in this way cannot satisfy the standards of modern scientific history. This goes for the biography of people like Jesus also. The Buddha is presented as a type rather than an individual. He speaks as an Indian philosophical tradition demands. That is, he speaks solemnly, formally, and impersonally. Remember, he's rebelling against the organized religion, the religious structure of his time, which is the Brahmins control everything, and they need big bucks to do ceremonies, and they're the ones who memorize and pass down the Vedas, for instance. The Buddha was trying to find a new way of being human. In the West, we prize individualism and self-expression, but this can easily degenerate into mere self-promotion. What we find in Gautama, and she uses the Pali consistently through the book, so instead of Gautama, it's Gautama. What we find in Gautama is a complete and breathtaking self-abandonment. He would consider our, quote, our modern idea of personality as a very dangerous delusion. Remember that person comes from the Latin personare, which refers to a mask. It is what you sound things through, personare. So in Greek drama and Latin drama, which followed it, all the actors wore these masks. And the mask also helped resonate the sound, so it carried. And that's where we get this idea of personality. I spent 3 days at a Benedictine monastery on my way here. A friend of mine who I knew from my years in Hawaii is now the prior there. It's 30 miles outside of San Luis Obispo. And I was there Vespers, which is usually a late afternoon hour service. Their Vespers is in silence, it's complete meditation. They put out the host in a monstrance and so on. So I sat there with the monks for a half hour, and then I hear this bell, and it sounds exactly like this. Sounded exactly like the one I have at home that we use in our little sangha. It's a Nepalese pounded bell. It's even on the same green brocade pillow. And I hadn't seen it before. The brother who rang it was slightly behind me. I turned and I saw that. So we are teaching each other. Buddhism is coming through to some of the other churches. Excuse me. I work very closely with an Anglican priest, and her bishop turned over an unused church to her in a small coastal town. And I go there every Thursday with some of my people, and it's just a mixture of people who are the frail, elderly, the homeless, people who just need company. And there's always a service before lunch, and people cook together and or bring stuff, and there's you know, really good kind of down-home food. But they have rules up for speech. And, you know, like, in here, you've got to follow these rules of speech. And it's the 5 questions on skillful speech. Is it kind? Is it true? Is it necessary? Is it helpful? And finally, is it the right time? Anyone who's kept a marriage together knows that is it the right time is a very important thing. There are times you do not bring something up, either because you're too mad or too upset, or because your partner would be, and so it's not time. That's a very difficult thing for especially for Americans who think that we can just blurt out whatever we want because we have our personality, we have our right to speak. Buddhism is getting in there. Mindfulness and so on, compassion, it all sounds very good. But if we go back to the Buddha's story, we know that his father, Suddhodana, his father tried, like every other parent, to protect him. But his father had an agenda. His father wanted him. There was a prediction at his birth that this child is either going to be a very great teacher or a very great monarch. And of course, Suddhodana wanted Gotama to take over from him and take over the kingdom. Also in that connection, remember that the word Sangha is a word that referred to the council of elders that governed many of the communities in northern India at this time. But I was mentioning to someone how I've had at least one teacher who I didn't realize was my teacher at the time, Isan Dorsey in San Francisco. I hung around him a long time, and he helped me get into Zen Center in San Francisco. And he used to, he was not the perfect monk. He had once been a professional drag queen. He knew all these people from the North Beach era. He knew Phyllis Diller and Carmen McRae, jazz people. He and Carmen used to argue about which one of them discovered Johnny Mathis. So anyway, that was quite a scene that he was in. And then he discovered Zen Center and Shunryu Suzuki, who loved him and just saw what his capabilities are. The beautiful thing about becoming a monk is that it gives you great freedom at the same time that your life might look from the outside to be very restrictive. You know, you follow a schedule, you have rules, and so on. But within that, we recognize each other. You know, there's a Catholic monk and Muslim Sufi monks. All of us lead very similar lives. We recognize each other. When the Dalai Lama visited Gethsemane Abbey, the famous Thomas Merton's place, the famous abbey in Kentucky, the Dalai Lama went right up to the abbot and said, "Oh, I'm so sorry for you," because he knew what running an outfit of what running a community, a spiritual community, is like, what a huge responsibility it is. All of us have rules that come from somewhere. The Benedictines have the rule of Saint Benedict. The Franciscans have to follow the rules of Saint Francis. One of the rules a Benedictine told me once is they have a rule of hospitality. If anyone comes to the door for hospitality, you must treat them as if they are Jesus himself. And this monk told me, he said, you know, some days I hear that buzz and I go and I open the door and I say, oh Christ, not you again. But that's it. We have to treat everyone as if they were a Buddha, because it's not even as if. They are, and so are we. But still, as monks and nuns, we do give up things. Things like snazzy black cars, or low riders, you know. It's difficult sometimes. But this robe is an insignia of rebellion. Someone picked me up the other night to take me to a AA meeting in town. And she had the radio on, and it was High Desert Rock. Does that sound familiar? Mm-hmm. Anyway, it was just going on and on. It was blaring, and it was like, get out there. This is after like 10 advertisements in a row, and then get out there and shop. Get out there and shop. And that's how we hide from our suffering. Buddhism and any authentic spiritual path requires that we accept fully, experience fully our suffering. Down the road in 10 minutes or so, you may be, saying, what a beautiful sunset, and I feel just great. That's the nature of our life. But we've all spent time with our addictions, and even those of us who think we're not addicted, we are too. We keep repeating the same mistakes. We keep using consumerism, for one, to bind our wounds. I have a practice when I go into a market of looking. If I know the place and I know the aisles, then I just look down at the floor and I go toward where it is I need to go. Because if I don't, I will get trapped. I've never tried that. Oh, less salt. Well, maybe. And so on. The stores are laid out very scientifically to capture our attention, you know. To get a donut at Safeway in Aberdeen, I have to walk through the wine section. And then I'd stop and I, oh, that's a nice label. I never had that, you know. I could spend 10 minutes distracted by, oh, that must be a new winery. That must, so there's all these ways to hide from our suffering. Yet all of us have these great wounds, great disappointments, great fears. But that's okay. Remember that the Buddha, in the fruit of his extensive practice, is the Four Noble Truths. And those are not dogmas to memorize. They are four things to be experienced. And then, after we've gone through that, we get to the Eightfold Path. And please remember that mindfulness is number 7 on that path, and meditation is number 8. So he wants us to do a bunch of things first. We cannot sit on our pillows or our chairs and expect to achieve some kind of enlightenment or happiness if we are leading unethical lives, if we're cheating people, stealing, selling poison, you know, all the things about right livelihood, if we're entranced with intoxicants, you can't sit. I know. I hid my drinking in a temple in Hawaii. I had my own entrance in the back, my own room there, and there is nothing worse than going to meditation at 6 a.m. with a hangover. It is awful. Talk about hell or bardo. So our response, I tell my Sangha, whenever you don't know what to do, pick the simplest thing. Don't complicate things. Just simplify. Figure out what has to be done and do it. Pick the simplest thing. But also, if it's a quandary with other people, pick the most generous thing. So what is simple and what is generous? I was going to talk about some of my experiences on Amtrak because I've had going up and down between Olympia and Trout Lake Abbey during the 2 years I was a novice. I spent a week every month there, and I had so many experiences. One lady got on, and she got on like in Vancouver, I think, Washington. So about an hour's ride from Vancouver to Bingen White Salmon, which is where I get off. And she got on, the place was full, the only seat was next to me, she sat next to me, and she began immediately. Well, Uncle Clyde was just telling me how so-and-so, as if I knew who Uncle Clyde was. She just went right into it. And she just kept talking and talking. And at one point, she lifted up her big kind of handbag that was almost a basket. And I glanced over and I saw all these medication bottles in there. And I thought, oh, okay, I got it. And so finally, she was running out of steam. She looks at me and she says, you know, you're dressed like a monk. And I said, well, that's because I am a monk. And she said, well, monks are kind of into silence. It must have been difficult for you to be sitting next to me. And I said, well, it was, but I'm over it now. And she cackled. She burst into laughter. She thought that was the funniest thing she'd ever heard. Oh. I won't go on about Amtrak. But I've got a lot of Amtrak stories. We can't do it alone. So we need the support of the Sangha. The teacher needs your support. We need to support each other. People are always giving me rides. Now that I still have a driver's license, I just don't have a car. And so I have to ask people for help. Can you run me to the post office? And I feel bad about it sometimes, but it's my time to get to know someone and their time to be with me. And we've all probably had this experience. People are much more honest in a car when you're just kind of, if you're a passenger, you're just looking out at what's going by. And people say all kinds of very honest things. So I get to know the young family that took me to Olympia at the beginning of this current trip. Her husband is the senior person in my sangha, who's an atheist Buddhist who won't take precepts. He's absolutely, that's too much for him. But he's one of the longest, most faithful, most helpful sangha members. So this was his wife and two young daughters. And the daughters were just fascinating. They both had books in the back, and I was asking them to read part of the book, and they were showing me the pictures. Oh, this one has really good pictures. And they'd pass it up to me, and I'd look at it. And so I got to know a lot more about that family, and they got to know more about me. Sometimes Chris brings his older daughter to our regular Tuesday night meetings because she has not Tai Chi, martial arts. She has martial arts after. So she sometimes will sit with us, and other times she'll go in the kind of second room that I use for an office and library, and she'll read there until it's time to go. But I really like the fact that we can create these spaces of safety and encouragement for all of us. I might think, well, these nice middle-class children you know, they don't have any big suffering. But they do. Children suffer all kinds of fears and injustices that we don't know about. So again, we're back to not suffering. The word I prefer is dukkha, because dukkha is untranslatable. It can mean so many things. But basically, at its core, it means things are awry. I kind of like that. Dissatisfaction is another one. So what we do, our mission, is to study, to experience this awryness, these fears, and to be as simple and as generous as we can be. Thank you.